14 years, 5 days a week with these children, and I treat them like my own. And I know the other staff have the same personal bond and will have suffered as much as me in their own way. To break this bond will be a massive wrench for the staff and the children. We are a united family. This has been a long and emotionally draining year for everyone, and it's taken its toll on us all. If the cabinet make the decision to close, we will have no hesitation to pursue all means of industrial action as our disposal. I think that gives you a very good picture earlier of the staff's thoughts in relation to this and their very emotional reaction, and quite rightly to what's going on here. We then move on to decreasing pupil numbers. This is a matter which we've gone over and over. We've provided evidence by way of somebody giving evidence of the call and meeting of the school not being offered to them and then being actually dissuaded away from that. With the threat of closure for 8 years, there's been no capital investment in the last 8 years. It's not surprising. In fact, it's surprising that anyone has actually sent a child to the school, and I think it's a testament to the skill of the school that any parent actually has bearing in mind what's going on there. They're then going to retain the ethos of the school and talk about, again, many times talk about canvassing the opinion of the parents. We've done that. We actually have got a parent questionnaire. I have a number of copies for you here, which you if you want to look at. We've had over 90% response from our parents. In fact, the only two parents who haven't responded is a child who's only been there 3 days and a child who is currently very ill. The results of that show overwhelmingly 100% that the parents want their children to remain in Lyndale school. There is, I think, very little. Two parents interest me, one in Sandy, one in Ellery, only if you have a massive amount more information. There is very little appetite for your proposal to move the children to Sandy and Ellery schools. So make copies of that. And enclosed on the back of that are comments that the parents have read. Obviously, they are not confidential, so they can't be identified. But there are comments, probably one between two, I'm afraid, that the parents have written, which may give you a flavour of what we think about the school. Moving now to the options, and I'm not going to go through all of them because quite a large number of them are potentially either not legal or not viable, and I will miss those out completely. And concentrate on A, first thing is the consultant, the independent person that's been employed to look at the SEN improvement test. When this was proposed by parents, it was anticipated this would be a joint instruction on the basis that the parent would have to have trust, or the parents would have to have trust in this expert, in their expertise, and in their capacity to understand the needs of our children. That didn't happen. Somebody was appointed for 18 days. That person spent 2 hours with a very small number of our parents, did not meet the parent governors. I had never met her. There was only one opportunity to meet her for 2 hours, and it was decided on the day before. This is somebody who, not sounding disrespectful to this lady, we received her CV, and I cannot see any experience whatsoever on there of her working with PLC children. Her background is in school reorganisation and finance. We have as well had a long meetings with the chief education psychologist, with all the children, as was proposed. I think during the call-in meeting, it was decided that was what the cabinet, the local authority, promised to do, to get a very in-depth picture of all the children. In our view, that was too slow. That could be used to ensure that the SEN improvement test was met. That information has not even been considered when looking at the SEN improvement test. In fact, my own daughter's appointment with the site was actually after the end of the consultation. So that information has not been included within this report. And as far as we were concerned, that should have been the basis of this whole consultation, and it simply hasn't been. One of the options is to retain Lyndale's take full range of CLD, complex learning difficulties. In a nutshell, this cannot be done in one sense because it destroys the ethos of the school, because that includes challenging behaviour children. What we can take, which is the best definition, is children without challenging behaviour. We are specialised in PLD because the local authority have allowed us to do that. They've consistently spoken to children and allowed them to come to our school. They've sat and watched it happen and allowed us to come that way. And also in the same way, Stanley School has become very specialist dealing with autistic spectrum disorder. All popularity of the school will have been affected by prospects of closure and the lack of investment. It has to have been. That auction is effectively written off then with no further consideration at all. It's simply, you become too specialised, it won't work. In the same way, Stanley schools have become very specialised as well, but something seemingly now, they are able to take CLD children, but it doesn't work conversely. We are specialised, but for some reason we can't take CLD children. It can't work, it can't have it both ways. Funding round change is what I've already mentioned. It should have been based on needs. We have the children's needs, put by the educational psychologist. It's an easy piece of work to summarise. And our main concern, and what we were quite distressed to find, is although we've been consistently told, it's not fair, you can't have any more than what we've allocated to you. We then find, by hook by crook, that there are a number of children in West Coast Residential School, I think approximately 44, as on a day basis, as a day school, and they're funded at an average of £36,500 per annum. Now, I'm not a great expert on that school, but I've read looked at their webpage and I've read their Ofsted report. They take a range of autistic spectrum disorder children and challenging behaviour children. Clearly some children their behaviour is so extreme that they cannot be dealt with in any other mainstream school. But are there really 44 children that cannot be educated in our flagship Stanley and Ellery schools that we keep getting told are been rated quite outstanding by Ofsted? And why is it that those children, I know they're educated out of borough, but they're still children and they're still allocated funding. And they're allocated funding of more than we would need to keep our school viable. And we would say that simply is not equitable. It is really just not fair. Also to note, interestingly, is that that school is 5 to 19. So we're all thinking it's good enough to send children there 5 to 19, but then try and improve the idea of becoming a 2 to 19 school. Moving on to that, the consultation that keeps getting referred to was from 4 years ago, nearly 5 years ago now. Only PMLD parents answered the consultation because it only affected them. You can't expect other schools or other parents to look at that when it simply didn't affect them. The decision in relation to whether it's 2 to 19 should be primarily based on need and not on cost. It goes on about budget implications for the other high schools and the other primary schools. If there are less intake from the other high schools than the other primary schools, then surely staffing levels will drop accordingly, and there should be no budgetary deficit for them. It's an easy thing to sort out. And also, we get told on one hand that only a very small number of parents are interested, therefore it cannot be viable. But on the other hand, it's mentioned in the expert's report that there may actually be other parents in Ellery and Stanley who are interested. And that would destabilise the numbers in both of their schools. Again, it can't happen both ways. It's either got to be one or the other. There are many 2 to 19 schools in the country. I visited one, D-Banks in Chester. It caters with every range of child, but I have to say that the MLD children are separated in their own unit away from the rest of the school. In a 2 to 19 school, interaction and inclusion is as possible as it is in our primary school now. We can interact with other high schools, primary schools, with the wider community. I know we kept getting told, well, children go through transition and they can cope with that. But we would say, actually, you know what? Transition is not good. It's extremely stressful. Children go through it now because on the Wirral they have no other alternative at all. I know one parent at the moment who's fighting and will fight till she drops in terms of not having the child taken to school. From our school, and I know other parents have taken it through legal channels to try and get the children to stay in our school. There are parents whose children are in high school as a necessity. That's not to say that they're happy there, it's to say that they have no choice. And there is no evidence, there's no study ever been done of the effect on transition on children. Obviously, the main point is in relation to the expansion of Ellery and Stanley schools and the closure of our school. It's always been the preferred option. We've been against it right from the start. It could not contain the ethos of our school. It's very hard to consider a provision that doesn't exist. In Lynn Wright's report, she starts her report by saying that it's only the only really viable option. But then at the end of the consideration of it, says, well, actually, it might not be yes in improvement test on week 1 because parents simply don't want their children to go there. Now, it screening test before you can go to close our school and move our children around. It will never pass point one of the SEN improvement test and our consultation document that we've got from our parents will show you that. I know I've never said their schools are good. They've also said my other children's primary school's good, but I wouldn't send my daughter there either. It's like comparing apples and pears. They do a very different job. They're very, very good at looking after the children that they've got, but they're not our children. They're a completely different type of child. The report is based on a lot of assumptions that children will not be brought back. High school children will not be brought back. It's assuming that some of the children might leave our school early. Assumptions are not evidence. They're not habits. You could assume anything could happen, but we don't know. We want inclusion for our children, but we don't want inclusion with children with challenging behaviour. That is not what we want. We never want them. There's a table of costs then that's broken down into, which shows our children being far more expensive, but we've had an issue with that right from the start, that it's not broken down on these, and really that should just be disregarded. Our main problem is with the health and safety. It's a huge concern for us. We keep getting told we have assurances from you in the schools and gaps in training will be addressed. That means nothing to us. There's no evidence, and training is absolutely no substitute for experience. We now know that there is no redeployment policy for staff, so potentially our children will be getting taught by completely new staff who have not had the experience of looking after a PMLD child. We sent pages and pages and pages of questions in relation to the future provisions to try and reassure ourselves, really, that the future provision would be suitable. They were very detailed questions. We received a reply to 90% of them at the last day of the consultation. There was no opportunity for us to bring up the answers to those questions again. No opportunity at any public meeting because the consultation had closed at that point. We were not happy with the answers that we were given. And we're not happy with where they were given either. We wanted to know mainly how the school could accommodate our children safely without exclusion. We asked for incident records from the school and we refused. There was a particular question that we asked in relation to a child when we went to visit Harry Park School with this governor. As we walked out of the head teacher's office, a child was running up the corridor of restraint with a member of staff running at them, and the child went and hid. And we pointed that out in our questions, and the answer was that this would not be a potential danger to any child. Children moving around the school are supervised by staff. Oh, I'm sorry, but the child, before my own eyes, was running on her own, unsupervised, like a mad thing, up the corridor, away from the member of staff who was running after her. All it takes is one of our children to be in the way. At the public meeting, in Stanley School particularly, there were staff present there who confirmed that they would not be capable of looking after our children. So the offer of, oh, we'll train them up, we'll sign them on, simply doesn't reassure us. We also reassure that funding will follow the child and therefore that the staffing needs will be kept up, but we know that the funding is potentially readily inadequate due to the new funding plans. The main issue that we've got in relation to Stanley and Emery scenario. We are told by the expert that we have to basically improve both schools to give us a choice of the schools. Stanley, with the paperwork we've got, has gone up from being able to accommodate 100 to 110, and now 120 children without any change. That's 10 children per class. All of our children are in wheelchairs. They could not cope with more than 5 or 6 in a classroom. So therefore, you're faced with the proposition of a half to three-quarter of £1 million bill or change to Stanley School over a period of 2 years, which you would have to do in advance of knowing whether any parent was actually ever going to be interested in that. Within those 2 years where the preparations are made for Cllr and Stanley Schools, I think this is really the most serious option, and this is where the SEN improvement test should just fall flat on its face. It's proposed that our children stay in Lyndale. And if you think about that logically, our staff have been fantastic. If you knew your end date was coming in 2 years' time, you've got a family to look after. No matter how much you love your job and the children you work with, your primary concern is going to be your family. And our skilled staff will leave. And I think it goes without saying, anybody would understand their position. Staff will leave. Our kids can't be taught by salary stuff at all. The school will stagnate. I mean, what would it be positioned? Would it be allowed to have intake? We have no idea what position the school would be leaving at that point. There will be no investment in the school, and I certainly would not allow my child to sit in the school for 2 years, which was just basically stagnating. It was just sitting there. I don't think that has any SEN improvement test. And why should she spend two precious years of her life sitting in a school that's going nowhere, waiting for a provision that might not be suitable for her? In conclusion, we have no faith in the system. I think we said that from the start. We still have many questions unanswered. We've been promised emails that we've never had. We've been given assurances without any evidence. We had a complaint from the last meeting, which isn't resolved. We've attended meetings which have then not existed. Parents have worked flat out on this, and at the end of the day, I'm a parent, I have a job, I'm a single parent, I have three children. I'm busy, to say the least, anyway, and to be doing this and having meetings and meetings and meetings is exhausting for all of us. We're not a big school, and we've all worked really, really hard, as I have to say. It needs to be concluded, but it should be concluded in our favour. I would say that on the basis of the fact that there is no provision which clearly passes the SEN improvement test and has the support of the parents, that any decision at this point to close our school would be completely inequitable. And based on the evidence in front of you, would be entirely wrong. If there was another provision that was sitting there ready, didn't require 2 years, then we may be in a different position. If potentially we were looking at co-location and federation, we may be in a different position, but we're not. The only option I would say that we have at this stage school open in its current format or extend it to 2019.
Thank you.
Children's services.
want tonight is to summarise the results of the consultation, go through the alternative options that's been identified, detailing, in our view, their suitability and the outcome of the SEN improvement test. So what I'm going to do is go through some of the key scenes from the feedback through the consultation, and then talk through very briefly each of the options. I do want to draw your attention to a number of appendices to this report. The first one being the independent consultant, so Lyndale will speak after me. There's a full chronology relating to discussions regarding the future of the Lyndale School, and maybe that chronology goes back to 2007. And give an indication of the uncertainty surrounding the school that Zoe referred to. Appendix 3 is the SEN improvement test. Appendix 4 is the Lyndale School consultation document. 5 is an analysis of the consultation meetings. 6 is a list of issues raised at the public meetings. And 7 are the notes taken from the meetings. The report recommends that Cabinet considers the content of the report and makes a decision on the matter. At the outset, I'd like to say very clearly that the central consideration at the heart of this report is that we protect and safeguard the future education provision of the pupils of the Lyndale School and ensure that we have good or better provision available for children attending the school should a decision be taken by members to pursue publication of notices to close the school. I want to affirm our and my particular continued intention to work closely with children and families affected and reassure parents of our continued commitment to their children. I do appreciate this is a really, really difficult time and we are seeking to bring the speed and uncertainty to a close as quickly as possible. Just very briefly about the consultation, it's been a process that started on the 2nd of April this year and ended on the 25th of June. And the report details how broadly we've disseminated the literature and how broadly we've elicited comments from people to capture people's views about the consultation. There have been 6 public meetings in 5 different venues to allow as many people as possible to attend. And there have been separate meetings with parent members and the Wirral South MPIs in the government. Members, elected members, also attended the Lyndale School and other schools mentioned in the report. The consultation was also publicised by our press office and the media. It was widespread coverage. It's fair to say we've done our best to encourage discussion and feedback. I'm going to just briefly go through some of the themes of the consultation that Zoe has touched on as well. I'll summarise them under, I think it's 12 different headings, very briefly. There are issues about the overall funding, some responsibility in the Lyndale School's proposal to the council needing to look at ways of reducing costs. Others asked why this was happening, when they understand that education funding is not being cut nationally and the dedicated grant is ring-fenced. And others felt that reserves within the school's budget should be used to fill the shortfall in the Lyndale. It is important to say, and we can say this in the report, that the council wouldn't benefit financially through any changes at the Lyndale School. And the money, should the school close, the money would follow the pupils to whichever school they attend. In terms of capital, the pupils expressed that we accommodate the Lyndale School pupils to other schools who cost the council money. Ask why I go to this additional expense. And I know Zoe raised the issue about there not having been capital spent on the Lyndale School